Welcome to step three, implement physical security. We start with another question. Is it more likely that a confidential file will be compromised by a black hat by defeating your firewall or by a visitor or black hat walking up to a PC and copying the file onto a thumb drive? In general, the answer is the latter, which underscores why you need to implement physical security. Physical security may seem to be common sense, yet it is often overlooked. If unauthorized people gain access to the physical network infrastructure, lots of other security mechanisms may be rendered useless. Physical access suggests at least the possibility of being able to bypass other security mechanisms. Physical security should be made part of your security policy. So make sure that you write that in. Begin by defining restricted areas and non-restricted areas. Obviously, a server room should be a restricted area. Network equipment such as routers, firewalls, patch panels, and cabling should be in a restricted area. Backup media or any equipment containing data should also be stored in a restricted area. Take appropriate measures to secure all areas. Consider human security guards, various kinds of locks, biometrics, key cards, cameras, etc. Visitors should be supervised even when in non-restricted areas. Define who is allowed into restricted areas by following the principle of least privilege. That is, only employees with a legitimate business reason should have access to restricted areas. Consider locking down end user workstations. For example, you may wish to disable the physical USB ports. That would stop the many exploits that use thumb drives, such as an employee taking home files or a visitor plugging in a thumb drive with malware on it to any convenient computer. Configure workstations with a timed auto logout so no one can sit down at someone else's workstation if the user forgets to log out. Eliminate unauthorized network equipment, that is, rogue equipment. The most common type of unauthorized network equipment will be end users who install a device for convenience or fun, not realizing the security problems that this can cause. They don't realize that they could be creating a backdoor into the network. The first step in dealing with this sort of thing is to make sure that your AUP clearly addresses what is and what is not allowed to be installed on the network, and make sure end users are educated about this. In my experience, more technically advanced users seem to pose a bigger problem. Of course, there is also the possibility that rogue equipment may be installed on your network by black hats with the sole purpose of doing harm. Rogue wireless access points deserve special attention. This is a very common type of rogue equipment. The most direct way to find wireless access points is to use a program like Insider to view all SSIDs in the area, specifically unauthorized SSIDs in the area. And last, consider disabling open Ethernet jacks accessible to end users. As most rogue equipment must be plugged in to an Ethernet jack, it will go a long way to preventing the problem. Cisco does allow you to disable ports on switches. That is the end of this video. We will see you soon in step 4.